If she had only been ugly, we would still be
together. We are live in here. We are doing a live, of course. Very smooth. There's a Dom Irrera live from Laugh Factory, it is. And we have a great ghost in here. Because, first of all, we invite him to come in here. Dom is very kind of like a... He always like to give every young comedian break. I don't. He didn't dress up for us. Look at the way he looked. Look at his ugly legs.
Is this an introduction?
Yeah, but look at him.
One of the funniest comedians around. A great guy, funny, terrific performer, terrific person, gets the hottest babes. Tony Rock.
Thank you.
And his brother of Chris Rock, and he's much funnier than Chris. Yeah, but because he's much funnier than Chris Rock.
Chris are different. They're
no,
brothers.
They are not different. He is funnier.
Let me ask
he's
you
a charmer.
Tony.
Yes.
As a black man.
Oh, don't even go there.
I'm kidding with him.
Well, why are you going there like that guy before him? And he said, you're black. I mean, it made me.
Good interview so far, huh?
Oh, great.
Hey, that was thanks for coming last time. We appreciate that.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
The DMV. You got stuck in the DMV?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I didn't have my passport. And,
is that what it was?
I lost my driver's license on the airplane. Thought I could just go in and give them my info and get it, have another new one mailed out, but you had to have a passport, some form of a ID with a picture on it. So.
How about this is your ID?
Yeah. I thought the face would work. I thought the girl would see me and be like, oh, that's, you know.
Yeah, didn't work.
No such luck.
Yeah, well.
So I have an idea for you, Tony.
I'm listening.
We had a guest in here, Frank Nicotero. He said if you lose hair, you got to put Leticia or something on
Propecia.
Your hair. Propecia. Have you done
that? Oh, when I walked in, I heard him saying something about losing his hair. Yeah. No, I'm not losing my hair.
He just has a close cropped haircut. He's not losing his hair.
Yeah, I'm good.
No, look at behind him.
I'm good.
Oh, look at behind him.
But
oh,
it's
my
not,
God.
He's fine.
He's losing hair.
He's alopecia, no.
They cut his hair
and I'm
short.
The benefit of being a black guy is once you start losing it, you just cut it all off. You just go Michael Jordan.
Yeah, that's right.
But some black guy, they have a good hair.
Right.
Good head. You don't have a good head. You have a big head.
He's sweet, isn't he?
Wait, are you trying to say I don't have a head that would look nice bald?
Yeah. That's what I'm
You have a head like an alien.
Let's hope the hair stays here, then, so I don't. I mean,
let's hope
you don't have a nice
have
head.
Hair.
Like Jamie was always known for his good head. Jamie gets good head.
This is a clean show.
Why is it clean? Because of my cock.
Oh my God! Excuse me. Can you cut that word? What
I'll
he said?
Cut anything.
Yes. Well,
keep
okay.
it real.
Yes.
I was saying that the other day when I was dyeing my hair.
No, I got a couple of questions to ask Tony. Can I ask him? Or
yes.
Do you want to ask him
no,
first?
No, go ahead. How would I know what you're going to ask?
First of all, Tony.
Fucking retard.
The thing is, this girl you brought in last time.
Oh, my God.
She was like a what are they calling? What's the
like
name of those?
Like a whore?
No. Stop. Oh. Not whore. No, she looked like a giraffe. Big, tall.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the model. She looks like the one who shaved her head?
She's from France, yeah.
What a pretty girl.
Yeah.
Imagine how pretty she is to look pretty bald.
No, but forget about it. Huh? Forget about
that's
that.
That's what made me talk to her.
Yeah, but forget about that. The legs,
oh,
I was
gorgeous.
Standing next to her. Her legs come to here.
Oh, everybody's legs come to there on you.
Stop. the whole thing.
Are you illegally a midget? Do you get midget rights?
Okay, all right. First of all, you can't say to the midget anymore midget. You got to call
dwarf.
Them. No,
short stuff.
Short
anyway,
people.
The time, was it any different from another girls? I seen you with some ugly girls.
No.
Oh, yes. You want me to name them?
He was never with an ugly girl.
Excuse me. The first time he came in a club, after a month, 2 months, one time he came in this girl. I don't know, it was girlfriend or somebody he came in with.
It wasn't girlfriend, no.
Her eyes, one was going this way, one was going this way. I'm not kidding. She was about.
He's out of his mind.
Good interview, huh?
She was about maybe 500 pounds with a Tony.
Hey, no way. He always has these exotic looking girls.
Yeah, but
like
that's
these.
Particular. He have a fantasy. He have a little dark side of him that nobody knows
is that
about.
I like fat girls.
Huh?
My dark side is I like fat girls.
Do you like fat girls?
No, I don't.
But do you like ugly girls?
I do not.
Do you like extremely ugly?
I do not.
What did you do with that girl? That's all I want to know.
That was before he became a strong act.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to get into the club.
Oh, but that's the time you wasn't strong act, you would have fuck any ugly
No,
girl.
You out of your mind, man.
Hey, it's a clean show.
Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. Yeah, but did you ever go with ugly girls?
Never, seriously. never. All my girlfriends have been very, very beautiful on the inside and the out.
Tony, you got two brothers? How many?
Seven brothers.
Seven?
Yeah. Oh, because I only know
two
about...
Sisters.
Okay. Two sisters. Two sisters, yeah.
Are they, where are they at in age?
They're younger than me, but one sister's 22, the other one's 26.
So Chris is older than you.
Yeah. And Charles is older than me. Andre's older than me.
But you have a brother who's a comedian who's younger than
Jordan's
you.
Jordan's my baby brother, yes.
And he's
the youngest out of everybody.
He's out there doing stand-up in New York?
Yeah, he's in New York.
He performing here too.
Yeah, he performed here.
Oh, okay. No, because we had, when we did the show, when Tony and I were talking on an interview, and he was telling me how supportive they all are of each other. I just think that's great.
I think part of Tony, he's full of shit.
He's full of shit.
He is full of shit.
I mean, you know Neil Brennan.
Yeah, of course.
And Kevin and him have a really, really rough relationship.
And I think Kevin is one of my favorites. And I didn't know that there was like a rift going on.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, when I first interviewed him, we used to do a radio show upstairs. I think you did it.
Yeah.
And he was saying that I said, well, you know, we were talking about auditioning because he had produced Dave Chappelle's show.
Right.
And I said, well, you wouldn't make your brother audition, would you? He goes, oh, yeah, I would. Look, but it's your brother.
Wow.
And he said, no, you have to read. Holy shit. Wow. And that's why, I was wondering, because I know you guys. I mean, Chris, you and Chris are totally hilarious, but completely different.
Yeah.
You don't have the same cadence. You never, which is kind of neat. You know, I mean,
it's weird and kind of neat. You know, the same.
But I mean, it's like you're an individual. You're like, I never seen you have a bad set, and I'm not saying that to make it the Sammy Modlin show. But you went up after Chris D'Elia, who is so fucking strong, and so are you. But you just made it, you had a laugh about it. Do you remember?
Oh, when I talked about his shirt.
Yeah. About how close it was to being feminine and all that shit. And just like, and boom, you had them.
Yeah, it's like a technique when you go up after somebody strong, you kind of
acknowledge it
and ride their wave. Like, even if you say something about a joke they said, to just try to tie it in, because the people are still laughing in the moment of that person. So I just, something they did, and then I just go with it into my set.
Yeah, when I first came.
It's a smoother transition.
Yeah, no, it's good to acknowledge the reality of it, because they can only laugh so much. When I first started, when I first came out here, I was at a spot at the Improv after Robin Williams and Jay Leno, and this is when Jay Leno was actually still funny, believe it or not. But I just said right away, I says, I know you were thinking, who's after Jay Leno, Robin Williams? Who's this? Don't they have any, like, an Italian guy I never heard of?
Yeah.
You know, and they laughed at that, and they realized that I was following these two legendary comics. Yeah. And
I went up one night here after Chappelle, and he did maybe 3 hours, and I
hung
out.
Oh, my God.
And he kept, like, I'm sitting up here, and he's like, are you still going to go on? And I'm like, yeah, I'm still going to go on. Like, I don't leave us, I'm doing my set. And I come up afterwards, and I said, you know what this is like? This is like you go see a heavyweight fight, and the guy gets knocked out in the first round. And then they go, well, let these other two guys fight just to take some time. It's like, I'm that fight. I'm the fight.
Yeah.
After the champ gets carried away, I'm that fight. And they just bust out laughing.
I actually remember it.
Yeah.
I don't know why Dave does that. And I love Dave.
Yeah,
but I don't know why he does that.
One of my favorites.
Me too. But I don't know why he does that whole marathon shit. I mean, him and Dane, I don't get it. I'd rather get up. Wouldn't you rather get off with them wanting more than just draining them and fucking asking them where they're from again and what were we talking about? And what do you guys want to talk about? That's bullshit.
That's what one of my comedy. You know Barry Berry?
Oh yeah,
I love Barry.
One of my comedy mentors. I always give them just enough. Always want leave them wanting more.
One of the funniest parodies of songs I ever heard was Barry Berry Bray to Prince's Barry Berry Berry Little Red Corvette.
Yeah.
I think it was. And, oh, man, you got to ask Barry if he has a copy of that.
I'll call him. I'll give him a
call. Yeah, he's a great guy.
He was one of the writers when you did Apollo. He was the writer.
Oh, he was?
Yeah, it was me and him. We wrote everything together.
He just had a show. He did he's the new host of the Apollo.
Yeah.
Oh,
he's,
great.
Yeah, he's doing a great in Apollo. I'm glad for it. But, you said something.
I'd love to do it, man, if they ever needed an elder. I've done the Apollo before.
Really?
Yeah. I love the crowd there.
Yeah, it's great.
It was so,
it is incredible.
So legendary doing that room. Yeah. Like just being on that stage. I got a gig, I haven't talked to anybody, but at the Opera House in Australia. I just think it's so cool to, like, be a comedian and go into those places.
Yeah.
Like Carnegie Hall or one of those, you know.
Yeah, where comedy doesn't go all the time to take comedy somewhere that hasn't been in a lot of places.
No, not changing the subject. Is you said all of the family, they are very supportive. I seen Chris. I brought it up one time to him. Chris never gave one audition or anything to Tony. Never, as far as I know. He did movies.
Way to cheer up the show.
No, cheers up the show. But you said they are very supportive. It's not
true.
Well,
he told me they were.
He's full of shit. I'm telling you.
So you're trying to start controversy between two brothers?
No,
maybe Chris isn't casting people.
It doesn't need to cast something. He said, my brother is a little part. I would give to anybody anything.
Has he helped you at all?
No.
Absolutely.
No.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Why would you say
absolutely?
You're full of shit.
And by the way, man, can I say
my
something?
My first TV appearance was my brother was on SNL. He did a skit, and it was he did a Two Live Crew skit, and he was Luther Campbell, and I was the other guy with the jacket on and the gold chain and everything. That was like my first time ever on TV.
I told you, can I say this about Chris?
Yeah.
I've told you this, I think, about him. And last time I saw him, I said, you got to stop good-mouthing me. You're putting too much pressure on me. But he has complimented me on a number of radio shows where it's gotten back to me. He said when he started out, he wanted to be like me in the sense of a respected working comedian. And he said some nice things about me. And that's totally, what does he gain from that other than saying a nice thing about somebody?
Right.
You know? Yeah, but I like Chris. Chris worked in here tremendously. And I love Chris and I love Tony, both of them. And I love the little brother too. What's his name?
Jordan.
I love little Jordan too. But what I saw, what you did with the Jordan, it was to me, that's what's the brother about. But I haven't seen Chris doing that to you. Maybe Chris did it. I don't know. But
who do you think's funnier, the Wayans brothers or the Rock brothers?
Oh, come on, man.
I'm kidding.
Don't even compare.
Not even close.
Yeah. Yeah. yeah, but he brought Jordan in. And it was Saturday night. He said, Jamie, give him part of my spot. Let him go up. And that, to me, made me feel like he is not selfish. He's care for his brother.
There should be music in the background. Yeah.
You know, and that, to me, meant everything. I don't know if maybe Chris did that.
Yeah,
I haven't seen it.
Jordan's my guy. That's my, you know, that's the baby, man. It's like that kid is, you know, he's loving to death.
Yeah, but does Chris do the same thing for him?
Yeah, he was, him and Dave were talking about going on tour together this summer. I don't know what happened. You know, Dave disappears, gets flighty.
And yeah,
I was like, you know, I got to get a couple of those cities. And he's like, yeah, I definitely, you know, I'll bring you out. So I'm like, if you do the Apollo, I want the Apollo. If you do, you know, LA, I want to get LA. And he's like, all right, cool. But then I don't know what happened. They stopped talking.
I was at the comic strip for his first spot.
Really?
Chris, yeah.
Really?
Eddie Murphy brought him in.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he was stuttering, actually. He stuttered, but you could see it was something funny to him. Never would I dream that he was going to be like he ended up. But, you know, the confidence wasn't there yet. He was 19.
Yeah.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah, I remember.
We're connected. Like, we're all so connected. You know, I was there that day, and I'm talking
crazy.
To his brother.
Then you did, of course, hosted the New Faces when I did Montreal.
Right. So, it all comes around. Yeah.
Chris was in here, actually. The first time he came to Los Angeles, he came in here. He said, can I go up? I said, yeah, let's put you on for a few minutes. He came up. He killed us. I said, come back again. And he kept on bringing him back and back. It was funny. And he would go to New York. And when he was in here, always he called, Jamie, can I come on in? I'll put him up. And the thing, it was for me, I mean, I'll bring in the show a little bit, make it more sentimental. was him and his brother Jordan. It's just like one year we had this, we do toy drive for kids.
Right.
And I had this kid came in here, his little kid who came in here, his name was Juan. You might have met him. And he came in here, he said, Mr.
His name was what, Juan?
Juan.
Oh, Juan. I think he said Wham.
No, Juan.
The guy Juan. Name is Wham.
And he came in, he said, Mr., I don't want no toy for myself. My mother is in jail. My grandmother can't afford to buy a toy for my two little sisters.
My papa was a Rolling Stone.
Can you give two toy to my sister? I just broke my heart. This little kid.
Way to slow down a podcast, Jamie.
Excuse me. I'm just trying to say he was sentimental, what he did with his brother. That's to me, it was a moment, everything. From then on, I love this guy.
Boom.
From then on.
A little tied in somehow.
I do.
Way to take the long way home.
Okay. Now, tell me about one thing about that tall girl.
She is in my house right now sleeping, and I told her I had to come here and do the podcast.
Yeah, but let me ask you. this tall legs, do they tie it around you?
Yeah. Nice, soft, beautiful.
She's sweet too.
Yeah.
Nice vibe to her.
Oh my God. I looked at her. I kept on looking at her. The legs would go to here. This is the legs would go to here.
He had one girl, an Asian mix girl that was just fucking gorgeous. Do you remember that one?
I think I remember me going like you said something.
You were out there. I'm going like this. Through the glass.
Yeah, but you know, the one thing about Tony does not discriminate. Tony, I see him with a mix. No, Tony
who
goes
to that when you're trying to
no,
get laid.
No, but Tony goes.
What's your background?
Tony goes with a Mexican, white, Asian, you name it.
You're right.
Nothing. I never you're see. Right. I seen him with every color, every
Jimmy, it's not that he's that. Most men would go with whoever the hottest is. Then I go, well, excuse me, you don't have any this in your background.
We're always trying to get the winner.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
No, but I could say a couple of comics I know that only they go with particular race that do not go with another people. I seen them.
Well, right. That's
I have
the
a friend that's an actor, BJ. He's been doing a couple of commercials, a couple of TV shows. Black guy, doesn't date black girls.
Yeah.
Like, doesn't.
What do you think he is, a professional athlete? Yeah.
I'm like, really, man? Like,
excuse me, Mario Joyner. That's
Mario Joyner.
Mario
has a bit about it. Funny as hell.
Yeah. He cannot go out with black girls. You know, I've seen it. He said, I cannot go out.
I never went out with an Italian girl.
Never?
Really?
No.
Yeah, Mario does.
Not that I wouldn't, but I just never.
Angry about it. It's really funny.
His sister's angry about it?
His sister's angry that the white girl that he was dating said that she only dates black guys. And Mario's sister's like, that doesn't bother you that she only dates black guys? And he's like, no, because I'm always going to be a black guy.
Right. So. That's funny.
You heard it.
Yeah. Mario is a very funny guy. We got to get him on your podcast one time.
I remember you, Tony, from when you did Montreal. Didn't I say something to you about
you said,
I know.
You said, I'm sitting on the stairs. I'm like over here sitting there, and the girl before me, I forgot her name. She's bombing bad. And Dom comes over and goes, hey, you nervous? I'm like, yeah. He goes, hey, look at the bright side. It's impossible to be worse than her. And I just start laughing like, you're right. That's true. I can't be worse
than her. No matter how bad you do, you'll
not
do better than her.
Yeah.
You could. Nobody's that good an actor to be as unfunny as this girl.
Yeah, and then everything else is smooth sailing after that.
I think if I remember, she had like a really good body. And I think...
Amy something?
I don't know. Maybe it's not the same girl I'm thinking of, but I remember being on stage and I saw her the next night and she had like this really, really hot body. And I said, you shouldn't have been on new faces. You should have been on new asses. But they would mix these because it was like a lot of pressure for these guys because they're all young comedians and except for like that lawyer from Boston.
6 minutes to you know,
six,
show your
7 minutes. And, you know, I try and loosen them up by going just to fuck with the other. I go, you know, this is 6-7 minutes that could change your whole life. You work really hard for this one moment. You got a lot of people you could let down. Have a good set.
Yeah. You know, that was a good year, too. The year I did Montreal was myself. Corey Holcomb was there that year.
Oh, yeah.
Mike Young was there that year.
Uh-huh.
Sam Tripoli was there that year.
Oh, that was time Tripoli fucked with me.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're friends now. But
was Chris Reef was there?
I don't know.
The commercial. That thing got a Hemi in it. You know, this Chrysler commercial. He was there. That was like our class.
That's a very good
group. We all came
in
together. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah. Well, like till this day, I see Tripoli. Hey, man, what's up? You know, we all still friends to this day. We came
together.
You
go through that one moment together.
It was the NBA draft for us.
That's exactly what it is.
Who manages you now?
Managed by Lisa Bloom, New Wave.
Lisa? No? Lisa, she managed all of Vane's brother.
Yeah, she has. I think she manages Marlon still. I don't know about everybody else, but.
Sean, too.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Who do you think is the funniest, Wayne?
Damon.
Damon.
After Damon.
Damon Jr.
After Damon Jr.
Damon Jr.'s child.
Damon Griffith the III.
No, I gotta tell you, the first time Marlon started doing stand-up comedy, he did one piece of material. I don't know if any of you remember. He got me on the floor. He would talk about an African-American guy. He got a part in a film, and his part was being shot. And he was get shot, and he wouldn't get the screen be on the screen longer, and how he made it.
He would just die. It would take him forever to die.
It would take him forever to die. You know, I mean, the whole thing did. And Marlon can act. Marlon is between all of them. He really can, genuinely, he can.
Isn't he doing the Pryor? He's doing the Pryor movie, right?
He's supposed to do
Pryor. He's playing Pryor?
I think so.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
It was, I heard it was between him and Mike Epps, and then something happened with Epps. So
he's
did you ever see Hollywood Shuffle?
Loved it.
It was a really fun movie.
It was one of the greatest.
Good times for you.
Oh, yeah. We were crying, laughing.
Yeah, the whole it looks like one of those movies that, like, I know that this is.
We had so much fun.
The stuff that's not on screen is funnier.
Oh, yeah.
Way funnier.
Because Robert Townsend was a friend of mine. We used to, I stayed at his place when he was doing Soldier Story. Mm-hmm. So we were
my favorite movie of all time, by the
great,
way.
Great movie. Mm-hmm. It was really Denzel's, one of his first big breaks.
Yeah.
And Robert was, you know, our friend. So all of a sudden he's a director, and he'd have like his coat over his shoulders, like he was directed. And me and this guy, Roy, I can't remember his last name, we would be, hi, Mr. Townsend, great to see you. You know, like Eddie Haskell shit. Fucking, it's so fun. We and the dancing. And I just like a really, because we would run out of money and then we'd stop production.
Oh, wow.
Remember?
And that was a lot of that was a gorilla. Like you just
He put it on his credit card. And, you know, like Robert took a bit from me. You know, like I don't give a fuck now. But we're watching Georgetown Villanova, right? Playing basketball.
Right.
I was for Villanova. He's for Georgetown. And he shows me this thing. And it was just like the beginning of Hollywood Shuffle. And one was the two black kids at the movie theater critiquing the movie. Mm-hmm. Very funny, right? And then he showed me some other thing, a school for black actors, teach them how to be more black.
Right, right.
But I had a bit that I'd already done on television, Italian actors teach them how to be more Italian, crank up their ass, forget about it, who died and left you, boss, one of these things. I said, Robert, you know, that's like my bit. He goes, no, it's not. I said, well, he goes, well, why don't you do some parts in the movie? Like, he's like, fine. I go, all right, fuck it. Like, what am I going to do? I already did the bit on television. But, it was fun. I'm glad you saw that.
Oh, great movie.
But you, people, they don't know. You two, you have, besides being a comedian, you have something in common.
Me and Dom?
We like hot chicks.
Yeah. No, forget about the hot chicks. Both of you been arrested for alcoholic.
Oh, my God.
You got a DUI?
Oh, yeah.
When?
A year ago. Like 2 years ago now?
A year and a half ago.
Yeah.
What was mine? 3 years ago.
Yeah.
How'd you get yours?
Ah, so stupid. I went and got a couple glasses of wine. I drank them only because I wanted to tip the girl. And I didn't want to make her feel like, you know, she was like a servant.
Right.
And just like tipping her, here you go, babe. So I thought, let me drink a couple glasses of wine. And I had it right at, like within a half hour. And I go to a gas station. It was blocked up. So I come out and I'm going kind of fast, but I'm looking for a CD. And I'm you know, I know that there's nobody on the road. It's late. And they just, they recognize me. And they still arrested me. You know, they could have let me go.
The guy that arrested me didn't recognize me. And then when I got to the jail, I was a black lady, corrections officer, officer. I don't know what you call.
Yeah, yeah.
And she was like, "You don't know who this is?" And told the guy. He's like, "Why didn't you say something?" And I'm like, "Well,
it's because he already wrote you up."
I'm on the 101 late at night. I'm gonna go, "Hey, man, you know who I am?" Like,
yeah.
I wasn't taking no chances, man. So.
But if you said something,
he would have let you go.
The way he said it was like he would have, you know, it wouldn't have been this extreme. He was like, you should have said something.
Oh, he would have given what is it called? There's something below a DUI that they give
reckless
you.
Reckless driving, something like that.
Yeah.
I was speeding.
Yeah.
And then the couple
How
of other cops
you?
Came in. You know what? This is what happened. Naeem Lynn? Comedian Naeem Lynn?
Yeah.
It was his birthday party. We're leaving his birthday party. Everybody's a little, you know, we had some drinks. And, I'm like, hey, let's get some girls and take them back to my house, keep the party going. So I get to tell like 5-6 girls, meet us at the house. A couple guys, hey, follow us to the house. So we all convoy into my house.
Right.
And I'm speeding because I'm thinking I'll get there and clean up a little bit.
Right.
Right past the cop. And then when I slow down, he just pulls me over, passed all the tests, and then blew, and it went over.
What'd you blow?
Man, 1.6, something like that.
Oh, that's higher than me.
Yeah.
What was yours?
1.2.
How? What's it supposed to be?
0.8.
Oh.
Which is really tough. If you have a glass of wine, if you have Listerine, if you rinse your mouth out with Listerine and you blow, you'll blow stronger than a 0.8.
Really?
If you have it in there long enough.
And you know what? When I was at the DUI class, they made me take the classes and all that. Did you have to do that?
Yeah, of course.
It was a guy there that said he said his first one, he was like, my first DUI, I acknowledge I was, you know, driving drunk. My second one, I was driving drunk. He said the third one, he had mouthwash, and they any type of alcohol now,
yeah,
he gets a DUI. He's like, and since he had two prior, they didn't believe him. And he's like, I swear, he was like, I swear, bananas, mouthwash, I rinsed my mouth out, got in the car, they pulled me over, but I had two prior, so it wasn't they were gonna just take my word for it.
Now, has it changed your life?
No, not really.
I mean, you still drink and drive?
Oh, no. I rarely ever drink and drive. Like, when I'm here with him and he's like, want to drink wine? I'm like, no, I got to drive. But if, like, one of my boys is with me,
yeah.
All right, I'll have a couple drinks. But it was I was never, like, a type to just drink. Oh, I'm behind the wheel.
You know, Tony's one of the only guys on New Material Night that actually does new material.
Oh, my favorite show.
Yeah.
My favorite show. Who's doing it tonight? You?
I am.
Yeah.
Are you here?
I'm not on it. I'm not on it. I on it?
No? Yeah, you are on it.
I'll come by.
Okay. Yeah, you are on it. The thing I seen... Tony going to the jail, going to all of that stuff. After he came out of the jail, he have about 15 minutes of new material.
Oh, yeah.
He's talking about this alcoholic guy on his shoulder, little thing.
The
alcohol man. Go fucking do it. Yeah, you could do it. I mean, to do what?
It's like alcohol is the friend that pops up on your shoulder, talks you into trouble, and then disappears.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, hey, the cops can't catch us. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, he does. And you guys, each one, how much you guys to pay? About $20,000.
I don't know, but I learned.
Not that much, but it did cost
it
some money.
It was up there. I learned a lot. I learned that alcohol can impair your coordination. I had no idea. Well, tidbits like that.
Oh,
who
you
knew?
And you start doing material about you never get, you never get an erection.
No, the joke was he handcuffed me, and I had never been handcuffed before and not had an erection.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, you guys both got a lot of material, but
that's great, Jamie. It was really worth it.
It's not worth it. It's not worth it. But at the same time, it was a horrible thing to see.
Well, you get material from trauma.
Absolutely, breakups with girlfriends, all that stuff. You go right to the stage, boom.
So that's the reason you talk about the girls.
No, I'm just saying, like, whenever something goes on in your life.
Were you ever in love? Did you ever work close to get married? Yeah, I remember one girl.
Who?
The girl you said she's the one? She was waitress here?
Jamila?
Yes.
Jamila?
Jamila? I could have married Jamila.
Yeah.
I could have married her.
She was a nice girl.
Possible.
She was a nice girl. She was a sweet girl. She loved you. But you just...
You arrogant. You ruined it all.
Then I got a TV show and everything changed.
Yeah, like,
hey, I got a sitcom. Next thing you know, it's like just chicks everywhere, man.
Did you really get a sitcom?
When I got All of Us.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah, All of Us was on for 4 seasons.
Right.
And everything just...
Yeah, you
road.
All...
I was on the road and movies. It was just like, what the hell? They can't prepare you for this, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, but one thing about you, I got to tell you, you know... Everybody I see, they come in here, they get a TV show. That as soon as they get a TV show, their attitudes get changed. Tony did not get changed except one thing happened to Tony. Tony got entourage coming in all the time.
No.
He's son of a bitch. Wait a minute.
They're just friends.
Don't say no.
He doesn't have a posse.
Posse? That's what you call it?
Posse. Okay. Like Russell has a posse.
Okay.
Russell, yeah.
Yeah.
Always,
no, he has a posse. He has a
he
DJ.
He brought 10 guys here to do the podcast.
He has a DJ that travels with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you have your posses. Excuse me. No.
There's nobody here.
Excuse me. Today is not here because you're talking to two of your friends. But you go anywhere. You go at nighttime. How many people posses come with you every night?
I went out last night. It was probably 4 people with me.
4 people. And 3 of them go.
They expect
in front
you to pay every time?
No. I was like, they actually paid me to host the party last night. So
oh, okay.
It was like, you know, free money.
Oh.
Hosting a party?
Yeah.
Where?
In Hollywood last night, some spot called Eden. And it was the movie Sparkle. They had like a cast party. I hosted it. It was nice.
A lot of girls. Thank you for inviting me and Dom. We are in town.
The next party I go to, you're inviting me.
He wants to invite guys older than him. Are you hanging out with this chick exclusively now?
No.
Oh, but she's staying at your house.
No. She came to the party with me last night, so she just passed out. I just let her stay. And then I had to come here, so I'm like, hey, I'll take you home later. I got to run and do this.
She didn't have a car?
No. She doesn't even know how to drive.
Perfect. She's trapped. She's trapped with you.
Something about her. I actually... really fantasize about this.
The ebony goddess.
Is something about her.
Ethiopian.
Is it? can I smell, as Dom would say, can I smell your fingers?
I thought it was a clean show.
It is. Smelling fingers, there's nothing wrong with it.
Oh, okay.
Excuse me, I'm not saying smelling anything else. That's all learned from you. You say it on the stage in front of people.
Brings
come on,
a lot
Jamie.
Of energy
what,
to
what
the
you
show.
Say? What do you say? What
I don't know.
He comes in here. He said, oh, your girlfriend's so-and-so. Yes, here it is. I was with her. He said, come here, smell it. In front of everybody.
Oh,
in
Jamie,
front of
Jamie,
everybody.
It's called comedic license.
Oh, a comedian license.
Tony wasn't even here yet when you were with Sabrina. He almost got married.
You almost
this
got married?
This was the last white chick he went out with.
Really?
The Asians.
How long ago was this?
That was right before you got in here.
Wow. What happened to her?
9 years I went with her. Out and I was asking her marry me and she said no. She was an actress.
She couldn't marry him.
She worked here?
She was trying
she was
to be a comedian.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
I never knew this.
Yeah. I was.
Where's she at now? She's still.
She's assumably she got married. She have kids. She
not
have,
doing comedy anymore.
No, she producing film now.
Oh yeah. Okay.
She producing
wow.
film.
Wow.
So tell me, what do you want out of this business?
Oh man.
Pussy.
So oh. many things. I want the HBO special, of course. That's like the, you know, that's the heavyweight.
The hour or the half hour?
The hour. I want the hour, man. That's when you get the belt, you know. I would love to do movies. I would like to produce, of course. I realize that, you know, there's a shelf life for in front of the camera. So you got to go behind the camera at some point to really stay around.
Yeah.
If you look at sitcoms from the 70s, 80s, 90s, people in front, faces change, names behind, when there's credits rolling, same names.
Yeah.
So I want to be one of the guys behind.
There's not a shelf life to stand up.
No, I'm going to do stand up forever. That's never.
Yeah.
That's not even a question.
Isn't that great?
I'm never going to stop doing stand up.
Isn't it great to get, you could lose a job and then go to work?
Right,
that
exactly.
Night?
With the actor's strike when everybody was scared, it was like,
yeah.
I'm on the road, like, you know, 40 weeks. What are you
I know.
Yeah,
there
so
are
I'll never
few,
stop doing stand-up.
Few comedian, Dom, you, Chris, him, few comedian I see that they go on the stage, they love to go on the stage. They enjoy being on the stage.
Yeah. Well, the audience feels that.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the reason you see, I come in here, I sit down, watch you, or stand up, I watch any of you two. The reason I do, because I love to see you enjoy. You enjoy
yeah.
being on the stage. That's important to me. That's to me, may bring me such a joy to see you guys
well,
enjoy.
I can't see myself, but Tony always puts the audience at ease because he's got confidence. And it's not even a cocky confidence, just like, this is funny. If you don't think this is funny, then I think this next one will be funny.
Yeah.
You know, you never like go with, what do you think? Like,
yeah, yeah.
I'll do something else.
My brother, Chris told me that. He said, you have like a comfortability on stage that I don't have. And he's like, I think people just pick up on it when you get up there. It's like they almost, when, as soon as you hit the stage, they're almost like, this is going to be fun.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you build that one. You didn't come to you easy.
Right.
You build it.
Right.
I remember first time you came to Los Angeles. I remember what's the name of that guy, Italian guy, called me.
Richard Tinkin.
Yeah, Richard Tinkin called me.
Couldn't be more Irish than him.
He's Irish?
Yeah, he's Irish. You just think he's Italian because he's tough. He's got a gravelly voice.
No, but I mean, I never met him one time he came in here with you.
Richie
but,
was representing you?
Yeah. You said something about it at Montreal.
Oh, did I?
Yeah.
He's a good guy.
Yeah, you said something like if he's with Richie, then he's in the right hands or something like
oh,
that.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Richie. Yeah, he was representing, and he called me. He said, well, he's there, but I called the improv. I can't get him anything going on, and got him in a store, and store, she's not giving him spot. Would you look at him? I said, yeah, and he came in here. He came in. I put him on the stage. He blew me away. I said, Tony, you come in next week. You start working, and I put his name on a marquee, and I did.
That's cool.
The first time he came in town. I saw him, and from then is how many years been about?
Man,
15 years.
Yeah, about. I've been doing stand up for 14 years, so I've been about 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah.
10 years.
So weird to think the young guys have been doing it that long.
I know.
Yeah. Like you're a young guy. You're a young head to me, and I'm thinking,
yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
You know, but the one thing Richard Pryor always told me, he said, "What make a good comedian? 10 years of stage time."
And I still think, like, even young comics younger than me ask me for advice, and I'm like, man, I'm still trying to figure it out.
Oh, yeah,
like,
me
14
too.
Years is new. That's new.
Yeah, I mean, that's all I'm trying to do is improve. You know, you just try and get. It's just like sports.
Right.
If you don't get better, you get worse.
That's what. Mm-hmm. That's the beauty of it, though. Like the number one is like we can do it forever.
Yeah.
And number two is like no matter how long you've been doing it, you should still more
find
to learn.
Something.
There's still more to.
Yeah.
Because life's changing every day. Is something new to write about. So.
Yeah.
You know.
And you know and comedy, the situation of comedy, the way of, you know, 10 years ago was different. Comedy was going on. Every time comedy is changing all the time too. You know, you got to go with them. But some of the comedian I know, I love them. They've been here for 30, 32 years. They still really doing the same joke they were doing, for example, 30 years ago. I mean, I remember one of the comedian came in.
Leave Frasier out of this, will you?
one of the comedian, I got to tell you, I'm using his joke. Dom, you will love that. He came on the stage. He talking about, he went to... what they call it, the phone booth to make a phone call because his car ran out of gas or something. And he put a dime in to make a phone call. And the dime. A dime, yeah. And
the phone booth.
Yeah. And
yeah,
phone
right.
Phone booth. And the dime and the person, they couldn't get the line through. And the operator came in. He said, well, we can't get the line through. Can we send you the money? He said, yes. And meanwhile, he said, we sent you a check for... what they call it, for 10 cents. At that point, he said, the stamp was 8 cents. Now the stamp is 45 cents.
Wow.
Yeah. The phone call is 75 cents. And his joke it is, he got the check.
Who is it?
He went to the bank.
You got to tell us.
Byron Allen.
I thought
you said it was a comedian.
Yeah.
Bang.
Boom, out the park.
You remember his joke?
I do. It's like, yeah, I do remember that.
You know? Yeah, but he's going to the bank. He give it the check. He said, how do you want the check? He said, oh, well, give me 2 nickels.
Yeah, yeah, you know? I remember that.
He got so insulted one night. Yeah, he came in here to go on, and Jamie wouldn't put him on because he thinks he's like the star. Mm-hmm. And he's going to walk in here. Remember that? Did you do his show?
I did. I did his show when it was first on. When it was first on.
I hated it, though, because I hated that, like, contrived material, you know.
So you like fish, and then it's like, hey, tell us about your time you was at the amusement park. It's
okay, you like drinking. Tell me about the joke you did on the
no, the joke I did on his show was I did his show, and they when it was different, it was a different format. It was the four comics, and then he would throw to another comic at like a fake news, you know, program.
Oh,
so I was that guy, and it was like, so what are we talking about today? Today's topic is. And I did a bit,
yeah.
But it was more, but it was less bit, contrived than that.
Right, right.
But the bit was your bit. They knew what it is. They lead you to your bit.
Right.
Like, if I'm on the stage, I'm in here, I'm interviewing, I said, Dom, talk to me about your cousin. Well, you have a cousin, do you ever go to a bar? And you're going to get right to the material you do about your cousin.
I always hated that, even when I was a kid watching The Tonight Show, except when Rodney Dangerfield did it, because it was so obvious he was doing jokes and made me laugh.
Right.
Like, he just, like a machine gun. He fired out the set, then he fired out, and Carson was on the floor.
Johnny, one of my favorites. Johnny was my favorite.
Oh, he was the best.
I used to stay up late, though, get in trouble.
Like, yeah, yeah.
Bed at 10, turn the TV on real low, watch Johnny Carson.
Oh, I know.
God bless him. I drove him home so many times to Malibu.
Johnny Carson?
Yeah,
not
Johnny
to be a name dropper.
I'm sorry. I'm not being, but he used to, he used to drink a couple of drinks.
Performed here?
Yeah. No, not, he didn't perform, never performed in here. No, he would come in. He would come in and talk, you know, watch comedian with what's the name of that? His casting person was Jimmy. Do you remember his casting person?
Jim McCauley.
Jim McCauley would come in. Jim McCauley was dating one of the girls she was performing, was from Australia, Maureen Murphy.
Yeah, yeah.
And they would come in here, and Johnny would get smashed.
Really?
He loved to get, and he would get smashed. He would get a little bit of more loose, and he used to go out with a girl. We used to have a waitress in here. Her name was Littlemore, Swedish girl.
I'll take a little more.
Yeah, and he went out with her. And she would come in next day. She said, "Oh, I have Johnny Carson's this." It was a fun thing. But I drove him one time. You know, a couple of times to Malibu, I drove him with his car to Malibu and all of that stuff. One night he went in and he locked the door, and I have no money to come back home. from there, I got hitchhiked to come back in here to the club.
Wow.
It was weird.
I never saw Pryor here. I never saw Pryor when he was healthy. I would have loved to have seen him. You know, did you ever see
him? Yeah, never. No, never.
By the time I saw him, he was so grateful for being alive and so gracious that he wasn't funny. But I knew how good he was. He had nothing to prove to me, but he was like, thank you so much. And I'm thinking, you know, this guy's just glad to be alive.
Yeah.
Which is not funny comedy, but
Pryor was some of he was the best of the best, and I never ever forget it. He would come in, he would tell me, don't put my name on the marquee because I would say that bitch get upset from me for my name, and I wouldn't put his name on it.
About Mitzi?
About Mitzi. But he had a good thing going with Mitzi, whatever. And he would come in here and he would go on. And I never seen any comic through my life. I've been around the comic for a long, long time. One night, one person made me cry. I tell you, one night Richard went out.
Cry laughing or cry crying?
No, cry crying and laugh laughing. Richard went on. He made me laugh so hard that I roll on the bench there. I start peeing, and Paul Mooney was sitting like next to me.
He likes that laugh.
He and Paul Mooney, he used to do that, and I laugh so hard. Then he start talking about this whole thing about race and this, and everybody got quiet. I remember in about 5 minutes in his material, talking about the segregation and all
segregation.
Segregation. And I never forget it. In 5 minutes, I was tear coming in my eyes. I'm looking at everybody, crying, almost crying for 10 minutes. And then, about two minutes later, it started making everybody laugh again.
Yeah, well, he probably used that as a tool to get you down.
But he said to me, he said afterwards, that's, you could take the audience, in palm of your hand, do take them anywhere you want as a performer.
You figure, it's interesting. Can you imagine, like, what segregation really was like? Can you imagine, like, I see you going to the bathroom, I go, Tony, that's the white bathroom. You know what I mean? Like, oh, sorry, man. You know, it's like, it's as much as we know it happened, I can't imagine living
it's unfathomable.
That
bad.
That it's actually, my father probably saw it.
Yeah.
My father's in his 80s.
Yeah. My mother used to tell us a story. My mother's from a small town in South Carolina called Andrews, South Carolina. Maybe 2,000, 5,000 people.
Uh-huh.
Like one of those towns you drive right through, like, boom.
Right.
And she said, the kids in her high school, the black kids organized a sit-in at one of the diners they weren't allowed to eat in, and they went and sat at the counter, and the guy that owned the diner took all the plates and walked in the street and threw them all in the street, all his own plates, threw them in the street, and was like, I won't serve food before I serve niggas. And she was like, to this day, like, nobody goes in there. It's not there anymore, but when she took us to tell the story, she was like, nobody, don't ever go in there, don't ever go in there.
Wow.
I mean, then, you know, the sad part of it is...
There's a sad part?
No, the sad part of the whole thing, what you guys talking about, is, you know, I was in Iran. The people, the ignorance of people, not educated, they don't know any better. Yep. It's like Iranian...
I've met people who thought Jews had horns.
You ever
hear that?
I honestly God, I was in a Tennessee, in a Chattanooga, Tennessee. A lady, they introduced me. They said, he's Jewish. She said, can I touch your hair? I swear to God, in America.
Yeah.
But in Iran, they say if the dog come in, drink water from water fountain, you got to stone the dog to death. And these kids, they don't know any better. This little puppy, they stole it. You know, I mean, that's the type of... Then you look at it, you say, are these kids, they are mean? No, it's just because they don't know any better.
They need a comedy club. That's what they need.
They are ignorant. You know, it's just, you know, I mean, the time the lady told me about, oh, can I touch your hair? What do you say to her?
Yeah, I find, tell me what you think, Tony, but I find our part of the business very integrated.
I don't think
that we, you know, I mean, we sit upstairs, there's no anything.
But you know what? I think a lot of young black comics, they do kind of segregate themselves. Like, they don't, how many black comics you see just coming here on a Friday and Saturday to hang out and watch a show? But then on Sunday, for Chocolate Sunday, they're all here.
Oh, okay.
It's like, why don't you come in on Monday and see some Latino comics? Come in on Tuesday, new material.
Come I don't know that. I mean, I come in sometimes to watch.
Some comics
seen
don't.
Host that show.
It's like, I think funny's funny. Like, you know,
me too.
George Carlin is one of my favorites. I don't look at him as a white comic. He's a comic, you know?
Yeah,
it's like,
exactly.
Who else? Wanda Sykes. You know, she's not a female comic. She's a comic. You know? Bless you.
Bless you.
So I don't look at it like that. That's why I've always been able to enjoy everybody that does stand up.
Yeah, you know, I segregate by talent, not by...
yeah, that's the best way to do it.
I used to, what I used to do 27 years ago before I start comedy camp, I used to come, my favorite night was Sunday night. Before was Black Pack, then was Cotton Night, then was after Cotton Night was Paul Mooney's night, then it became Chocolate Sunday night. You know, because of my comedy camp, I got to be the kid. I said, do I have two choice? You know, and I that was one of my joy of coming to Sunday night. Sunday night was my favorite. The energy was in here. It was unbelievable.
Sometimes it's fun being like having a home crowd, like in the race or ethnic. Like I did an Italian show the other night. And it was fun, but I mean, I wouldn't want to do it all the time.
Right.
I mean, you wouldn't want to be at a rack audience all the time.
Right. You don't even really get to gauge your material if you do that all the time. You know, I want to see what the other ethnicities think about my material
as well.
That's
what's great about performing here.
Right.
You not only got that, you got like 60-year-olds and 18-year-olds.
Yeah. This is like the Friday, Saturday here is like the best audiences.
Yeah, but you know, the comedy is supposed to bring people together, not. This, again, I'm forgetting the name, disregard people from each other, races and everything. Yeah. This was comedy, bring people together, make them become a family. That's one thing I'm hoping, you know, and I see it. I see it in Chicago, a lot of places I go. I really see different things. I really think this, you know, in Chicago, you used to go in Chicago and some Midwest, you go, there was a lot of prejudice against, you know, Mexican against African-American, but now it's different. I see the people, they changing. I think part of it is great thing is about Obama. Realized he brought everybody, we have one of the greatest guy in the White House, is Obama. You know, he's make it change. I think he changed it. You know, he changed it. But, you know, again, that's comedy, you know, and I love see comedian. One day they don't have a chocolate sundae. They don't have a Latino night. They don't have to have anything.
I'd still like to see a black guy who looks like Mike Tyson in the office. That would really be breaking some barriers with a tattoo on his face.
If Mike Tyson start doing stand-up comedy.
He's doing a one-man show in New
York. Yeah.
He's doing. He did an MGM.
He's got
Vegas.
A good sense of humor
underneath all that,
you know.
Now that he's come to, you know.
Yeah.
Dude, he's happy in his own skin now, so to speak. You know
I was at the Improv, and I knew he was, this is when he was champ, and I knew he was in the audience. Mm-hmm. And I just start saying shit about him that was just really nice. I said, you know, he didn't know that I knew he was in there. And it was so fucking funny because he comes up and hugs me. Like, man, that was really nice of you to say. I said, oh, Mike, I didn't know you were here. I'm saying, he's so smart, people don't know. And what a great, because I thought, I don't know what you thought about him. Like, I don't know how old you were when he was at the top, but to me, he was as good as anybody.
Oh, yeah. He's definitely in the argument for one of
people,
the best ever.
Well, people would say, you know, he didn't fight anybody, but he fought everybody who was around. He didn't avoid anybody.
He unified the belt, so he had to fight three champs.
Yeah.
Right?
Muhammad Ali was number one, always in my eyes.
You know, but the thing is, he was of his time. I mean, Marciano was undefeated. They're all, you know, like when they talk about like the 1992 Dream Team, playing today's Dream Team. Well, they can't play each other. Right. So you can argue this forever.
That's what sports does, though. The argument is always the impossible.
So
it's never going to be. Tyson's never going to fight Ali.
Somebody beat Tyson was Joe Frazier. Do you remember?
He beat Ali.
Joe Frazier actually came in here, performed in here at the Laugh Factory here.
Really?
He came in and he did music. And he did stand-up comedy. His stand-up comedy, he could not deliver one word.
Could he sing?
He's singing. He did that James Brown song.
Yeah.
It was
Good?
Yeah. And he was moving with his legs and all of that stuff. Wow. It was very talented. I said it was very talented.
Joe Frazier.
You know, it was very interesting. And he said to me, he said, he beat Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he beat him. Not only that, they beat the hell out of each other three times.
Each other, yeah.
Yeah.
I think that, and there was a couple things where Ali just took unbelievable shots, which...
George Foreman fight was rope-a-dope.
Imagine what that did to his brain.
Yeah.
And he
can
won.
You imagine? They said George Foreman have nine kids. All of them.
All his, named George.
That's
George.
Hilarious.
Yeah,
that's funny. I mean, they have a George number one, George number two,
it's
or
like George, Jim, George, Bob, George, Tim,
little George, big George.
Yeah.
Oh my
medium
god.
Medium George.
Georgina.
Oh my god, that's funny.
I used to have a joke about sports, like about how like there's no rational. There's some rationalization in sports. Somebody thinks, they go, well, you know, I think he fucking sucks. Yeah, but he hit 340. He stole 50 bases. And, you know, he won the Golden Glove. I still think he sucks. You know, it's like it doesn't matter what the fuck you do.
When you're loyal to your team, the numbers don't even matter coming to the equation. You know?
Well, the Dwight Howard thing. You follow the NBA?
Yeah, of course.
Well, the Dwight Howard thing, it's like everybody, boo. Yeah.
He's on the Lakers.
Now, yeah.
He wants out of Orlando. Oh, he used to just stay there.
Yeah, what a baby.
Yeah, okay, cool. We'll take him.
What make person they become in America? They become they like the team. They become one of their own team, and they follow them. They do everything.
That's what sports is. You embrace the team. It's almost like you live vicariously through the team. Their successes and their failures become yours. It's like you literally are emotionally invested as if you know these people. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I've been a Steelers fan my whole life. Like when they lose. It's like on a Sunday and they lose. It's like that takes me a couple of hours to get ready for the day. It's just like, you know, told me this. Richard Jenny, rest in peace. He's a Jets fan, huge Jets fan, and he said every year he would like literally like lose weight and couldn't eat after a game, and it was like it was so depressing.
I didn't know he was that into it.
Yeah, and then he said, we were over there talking one day, and he said, and I made the decision like I'm going to take myself out of the equation. I'm just going to watch sports. Just, you know, for the entertainment factor. It's like I'm not going to be emotionally invested in any team. Whatever happens, happens. And he said that way he was able to enjoy the game again. And he said he's going to take that same approach with stand-up, not get too high or too low with his sets, and just enjoy being on stage. And then, you know, a couple of months later, I heard what happened.
I asked Seinfeld for help with a joke one time, and he lifted it. But we talked about it. He said he didn't remember, which is fine, you know. But it was right out here in the lobby. I said, Jerry, help me with this joke. Who do we root for in sports? Who is it? The owner? Some rich fat cat? Is it the uniform? Is it the city? Who are we really rooting for that we invest so much? Because the Ravens moved from Cleveland and then they became Super Bowl champs. But isn't that the Cleveland team that won the Super Bowl? And he added, so what are we rooting for? Laundry? You know. And I remember calling him up about it. I said, Jerry, thanks for trying that on Letterman. So I could do it at Bananas. Because what are you talking about? He said, "Well, I asked you for help with that joke, you know." And then eventually he apologized. But you know what he said was funny. He goes, "Well, you know, you can do it now."
Wow.
I said, well, after he used it on
the
TV.
Yeah, I said, "Jerry, you're kind of famous. You know, I really can't do it now."
Yeah. Wow.
That's interesting. Did anybody steal any of your jokes or anything?
No, I don't. I hear some stuff that's similar.
It's really weird when it stops you. You know it's wrong.
You know what? I was here Saturday, and I do the alcohol joke, and D'Elia has an alcohol joke. So whenever he's on, we're on the same show. I just watch him to make sure if he does it, I don't do mine.
Yeah, yeah.
But I wouldn't say he stole it. It's just really close.
You know? I asked him about a thing because I was doing this thing about it is what it is. Well, of course, it is. What else could it be but what it is?
Right, right.
And he did that, and I said, Chris, you know, he says, yeah, I saw you do that. I'll drop it, like that. Wow. Yeah. So. You know, sometimes it is.
Sometimes you get caught in the moment. Something happens in the room, and you're thinking, "I need a quick response." And you might say something that's like, "Oh, wait, so and so said that." Yeah. You know, but
I seen comedian, the open micers, they coming in, they stole Dom's array.
Oh, I've seen open micers do material word for
they
word.
They think that it's okay.
No, but you know, it's they. I tell them, I said, "This is so and so jokes. This so and so joke."
Right.
I saw, for example. A guy came in on the stage. I never ever forget. He used one of the old jokes he used to do. He came in and he started doing the joke, and he did it so bad. I said, "If Tony was in here, he would beat you to death."
He did one of Tony's?
Yeah. I said, "Oh, I said, you know what you're doing?" He said, "I said, you are not only taking his joke, but you can't even deliver
it. Delivering it right.
You're not even stealing it right.
Yes, at least if you steal it, have the timing, have everything going for it to make it work. So, oh, I didn't know I wrote that joke. I said, no, you didn't wrote the joke. The word is word by word is Tony's jokes it is, you know. But, I mean, you're taking at least if you're taking it. Like Carlos Mencia, he used to take people's material.
But he was good at it.
But he said it on the TV. He said it on a movie. He said, I did it because I did it better than other people. They were.
Yeah, that's what they said about, was it Pablo? They said Pablo does you a bit better than you do it.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it was Pablo.
Robin Williams walked down from the stage one night, and Rick Overton had this joke in his act, and Robin knew he stole it, and he wrote it. This is the legend that he wrote him a check immediately for like $2,500 for the joke. Sorry.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's just, you know, some people they doing it. I always been telling everybody, but Dom is disagree with me. I think some people like Robin is addictive to laughter. He is like a drug addict. He need that laughter. He heard your joke. He doesn't think the time is on the spot. He needed drugs. He doesn't care less if he take money from this guy's kid to buy his
drugs. An interesting way to look at it.
You know, that's Robin. But some people like, and other people that I see they take the material, they calculating. They take the joke and they change it a little bit around, tiny bit around, and they say, like Paul Mooney's jokes, I saw, for example, Carlos doing it, and he's taking him all of the subject and everything, changed them around, and that's, I think, a little bit, you know, not...
Makes it not as bad?
No, that's make it bad to me.
Oh,
but
okay.
The Robin, he takes it, and he's poor guy. He doesn't know what to do. And he started doing it, and he's go, oh, I'm sorry, with somebody's joke, I'll pay for it.
Wow.
Because he's addictive to it. He's addictive to laughter. He doesn't do it purposely. I don't think he's going to calculate. Go, I'm going on the stage. I'm going to do Dom Irrera's jokes. No, but he comes in, and somebody talking about child molestation, and he doesn't know what to come in. He heard Dom, he's talking about child molestation, he's done this, and he started using it. And he
you
doesn't
got a bit about child molestation.
I do, yeah.
Yeah,
but
he
I bring it back on myself.
Yeah, he does. He does.
Oh yeah, why not me, Father? Yeah,
yeah. What about me, Father?
Yeah,
I wasn't hot enough for you.
Yeah, I wasn't hot enough. That's a funny jokes because everybody, you know, and the way he does it, everybody love it. Nobody, you know, because he's all about himself, and he does such a great job.
You're not gonna go after kids. The Sandusky joke. Did you write any Sandusky jokes?
No. I didn't.
I just had one that was kind of gross. Was Sandusky? Did you see his teeth?
You did say something about that.
Apparently, sperm wears out your enamel because he had all green teeth.
Yeah. No, I didn't write anything about Sandusky. It was too weird a topic. And
well, one of my best friends was the prosecuting attorney in that.
Really?
Yeah.
Actually, you know, the time he won the case, I have people from Holland, from different countries, calling me. He said, Dom Irrera. The comedian Dom Irrera
Irrera. Still doesn't know my name.
Excuse me. Dom Irrera.
That's better.
You know, he said the prosecutor, the time he was talking about winning the case, he said, by the way, my friend Dom Irrera, he's a comedian, he's performing whatever he does. In middle
of Tropicana. They asked him if he would plug my Atlantic City.
Did he really?
Well, he said something about after the case, but right. I asked him on his opening statement if he would plug it. He said, how can I do that? I said, well, just say, you know, this man Sandusky has brought nothing but pain and heartache to so many people, unlike comedian Dom Irrera, who will be at the Tropicana at 8 o'clock. Tickets are still available.
That's funny. Did you say that?
What?
You said that on stage?
I did. I mean,
that's hilarious.
I thought was hilarious.
Yeah.
And the guy, he did part of it. On the time they were interviewing him about the case.
That's funny.
I thought that was
hilarious.
I gotta
see who I can get to plug some of my dates like that.
Yeah, right.
But you could plug.
You got any dates you wanna plug on this?
Yeah, I'm in San Jose this Thursday through Sunday at the Improv.
How about like in September, October?
September, I'm in Atlantic City, Labor Day weekend.
Where at?
Harris?
Chicago Club.
I haven't seen Chicago's Club.
Asking. Chicago look better on this
one? You see Chicago's
one?
No. It's not as nice as this or Long Beach.
Chicago's not.
No.
Oh.
Chicago is not?
I think this club's nicer. I think Long Beach is nicer.
But you,
it's very nice, Chicago. I like it a lot.
But you don't think that hallway with the memorabilia, the time you're going to the bar, the time you're going in the showroom. I mean, looking at it with that.
I don't go to clubs because of their hallways. I never hear a bunch of guys going, you see that hallway in that place? Holy shit, that was beautiful. That was a show. I don't even remember.
Isn't that
we were
club
in a hallway?
No,
most of
I mean,
the time.
If you were writing about your credit, writing about the creation of the wonderful club, would you say that club
if
is
were,
nice?
Or if you were doing the Zagat, nice, was yeah. it Zagat's?
Yeah,
yes,
was that?
I would give it a good review.
Thank you.
Five stars.
Five stars.
Tony okay, Martin. I have to go see it. I'll yes. check it out.
Yes. Tony, thank you for being on the podcast.
Thanks for
thank
having
you
me.
For leaving the
thank
babe.
You.
Wait a minute, we haven't found out about the. We want to get into the dark side of Tony.
Maybe
the,
he doesn't have a dark side. Maybe he's just a good guy.
What's
who's
my,
funny.
I don't have a dark side. Yeah.
Oh, he
I've never
does.
Seen a mean streak
I
in this
frequent strip
kid.
Clubs. I guess that's it.
That's bad. Ooh.
Okay, we got to get him back here. We got to talk
anytime.
To him again.
Anytime.
We got to get him back
right,
here.
We'll delve into him.
We got to talk. And right. we got to.
Thank
one
you, everybody.
Thing we got to do, we got to find out. When are you doing the movie with your brother?
Australia.
He said he's writing the script right now. I have actually an idea for a movie with him, myself and him. And
You and Chris?
Yeah.
That'd
he said
great.
He's writing the script now. So once it's done,
I'd love
you
to
know,
see you
I'll
in a movie.
Tell you
together.
All about
it'd
it.
It'd be hilarious.
Yeah.
Well, I got a movie for you and two other people to work on
okay.
called Three A-Holes.
Three A-holes?
Yeah. You are one of the A-holes.
Really? I didn't think so.
How'd you get that part?
Yeah, I'm writing it.
All right, let's do it.
Yeah.
You're writing
it. I'm behind him.
Can't even speak English. You're writing a movie.
No, I got you.
Thank you, everybody. If she had only been up.